Good morning. The topic for today is impacted teeth. For this lecture, we'll be concentrating more on mandibular impacted third molars. By end of the topic, the student should be able to outline the indication and contraindication of impacted tooth, discuss the degree of difficulty and risk associated with removal of such tooth, an appropriate type of anesthesia to be administered to remove the tooth, select appropriate surgical method and techniques for removal, and recognize perioperative and postoperative complications of surgery of the impacted tooth. So what is an impacted tooth? Impacted tooth is the one which is completely or partially unerupted and is positioned against another tooth, bone or a soft tissue, so its further eruption is unlikely, describing according to its anatomic position. A tooth that is partially or completely unerupted beyond the chronological age of eruption and will not assume a normal relationship with other teeth and tissues is an impacted teeth. So what is the difference between an impacted tooth and an unerupted tooth? So impacted tooth is the one which is that fails to erupt and will not eventually assume its anatomical arch relationship beyond the chronological age of the eruption date. Impacted tooth formation is complete and yet retained in the non-erupted position, whereas unerupted tooth is a tooth not having perforated the oral mucosa and its chronological age has not come. The difference between an unerupted tooth and a malpass tooth is a tooth which is an abnormal position in the maxilla or the mandible is called as a malposition tooth. So what are the different causes for impaction? There are two, local cause and a systemic cause. Local cause is irregularity in position and pressure from adjacent teeth, density of overlying and surrounding bone, long continued and chronic inflammation, lack of space due to underdeveloped jaws, unduly long retention of deciduous teeth, premature loss of primary teeth, obstructive causes, infectious causes. The systemic causes are due to prenatal, which is hereditary, or postnatal diseases like rickets, anemia, corn syphilis, tuberculosis, endocrine dysfunctions, and malnutrition. Some other rare causes are cleidocranial dysplasia, oxycephaly, progeria, achondroplasia, and cleft palate. Coming to the indications for removal of an impacted tooth in general, when there is a recurrent pericoronitis, when there is caries with or without pain, because caries can cause periapical infection and then lead to more serious complications than if the patient is medically compromised, if there is a periodontal disease, if there is an obscure facial pain, when the tooth has been attempted for extraction elsewhere for prosthetic reasons, orthodontic reasons, if there is an abscess, if there is an associated persistent tumors, if the tooth is in the line of fracture, and if the patient is going to go for radiation. So these are the conditions where an impacted tooth is indicated for removal. So these pictures show, the first one shows a caries, the second one shows a caries along with a periapical lesion, whereas the third one shows a root resorption, external resorption due to an impacted tooth overriding the second molar. The periodontal disease, you can see a lesion apical to that or distal to that of second molar, which is caused due to the food accumulation distal to the second molar, which breached the lamina dura and then entered into the distal aspect of second molar. Due to prosthetic reasons, you can see an isolated third molar, which hinders when the patient wants to go for a complete denture reconstruction on that particular arch. These are few pictures showing the pathological reasons for removal. A small lesion, mostly a dentigerous, or a large lesion, which can be a tumor on the other side. Contraindications, the first one will be health consideration, the same health consideration what you give for an impacted tooth is similar to that of indications for removal of an extraction tooth. The prosthetic consideration, availability of inadequate space, and then socioeconomic reasons. Winter's classification and Pellen classification are the two most common classification that has been followed to classify an impacted mandibular third molars. So Winter's classification, it is classified based on the long axis of the tooth, whether the impacted tooth is mesially tilted, then it becomes mesiangular. If it is distal tilted, it is distangular. If it is below the level of the occlusal plane, it becomes vertical. When it is horizontally placed, almost at 90 degree angle to that of the 7 or the second molar, or it can be bucoversion, lingoversion, or it can be inverted. So the other common classification which we come across will be Pellen-Gegrig's classification. It's based on two criteria, based on the relative depth of the impacted tooth in bone and based on the relationship with the anterior border of the mandible. So it has got position and class. So if the position of the tooth is at the level of the occlusal plane, then it is position A. If the position of the impacted tooth is in between the occlusal plane and the cervical margin, it is position B. And if it is going to be below the cervical margin of the second molar, then it is position C. Whereas based on the space available between the distal aspect of second molar and the ramus, it is called as class. When there is enough space but still the tooth is not erupted, it is class 1. When there is no space between the distal aspect of second molar and the ramus of the mandible, it is class 2, and if the tooth is embedded within the ramus, then it becomes class 3. This classification gives an idea about the difficulty also. So if you look closely, then class 2 and position C will be the most difficult one to extract because it's more deeply placed and there is no enough space for us to access. Preoperative assessment is one of the common thing which we do before we give or schedule an appointment for surgical removal of an impacted teeth. Age, to know whether it's impacted, whether the chronological age has been reached or not. Physical and mental status, whether the patient is willing to take up the surgery. And if the patient has got any systemic illness, so that it is contraindicated for removal of an impacted tooth or any other form of contraindication or a medical problems which contraindicates a removal of the tooth. On examining clinically, we have to look for mouth, the retruder mandibular position, whether it's protruder or retruder, the mouth opening, and the access. If the mouth opening is less and if it has got, the patient has got a small mouth, it is going to be difficult and the access is going to be difficult. If the mouth opening is large and large mouth and protruded mandible, the access is going to be easy compared to the previous scenario. How to make a good IOPA for a mandibular impaction? This is the most critical one when you are going to evaluate the radiograph for a surgical removal of a third molar. If the radiograph is not properly taken, you can miss the treatment planning. So there are some criteria that says that these things has to be followed when you take a radiograph. And the three things are the buccal and cusp and the lingual cusp should overlap each other for the second molar and the first molar. And only the distal root of first molar should be included in the radiograph. And the third thing will be complete root of the third molar should be included. If these three criteria are being followed, then you will not have an issue in planning the surgical procedure. After the proper radiograph has been taken, these are the interpretations which you need to look for. So you need to look for the axis, the position and depth of war lines. We'll discuss in detail about war lines in the later slide. You need to look for the root pattern. You need to look for the shape of the crown. You need to look for the texture of the investing bone. You need to look for the position and root pattern of the second molar. And you need to look for the inferior dental canal. So what you look for the crown? You look for the crown shape, size and carry status. If the shape of the crown is more bulbous and the size of the crown is going to be more big, and if there is no caries, then it is going to be difficult. If the size of the root is short and if it is tapered, if there is more acute curvature, and if there is more number of root other than two, then it's going to be difficult. So to put it simple, a short root, not tapered, not curved, with the two roots will be an easy one to extract, whereas the rest all are going to have some form of complication. So when you want to look at the morphology of the roots, these things has to be looked in carefully for treatment planning. So the size and shape of the second molar also has to be considered, because this will decide the elevation or the path of exit of the tooth. If the tooth size and the shape is big, this can hinder the path of exit of the impacted tooth, which I'll show you in later slide and discuss in detail. So the relationship with the inferior dental canal is very important, as you all know, that can cause paresthesia. So these are the three common interpretations that is being seen in the radiograph. If the two lines of the interdental canal are seen clearly without any disruption, the canal and the root are separate. So mostly the upper border line will overlap over the impacted tooth, whereas the second thing is grooving. The canal is being grooved by the tooth, so there will be some loss of the tooth structure. So if that is going to be grooved, then the upper border, there will be loss in the continuity. If the continuity is being lost in both upper and lower, then the canal has been perforated, which is very rare, as perforation is not common, because by the time the third molar root formation completes, the canal density has been, or already the ossification would have complete. So it is very difficult to see perforation, whereas grooving and separate are the one which you will come across more commonly. As already said, based on the angulation in relation to the second molar, you got mesangular, distangular, vertical and horizontal. So this picture shows how you are going to check for mesangular one. The mesangular, distangular or horizontal or vertical can be decided by having a radiograph and intraoral periapical view taken. If there is a line drawn on the long axis of the second molar and the long axis of the impacted tooth, if they both are parallel to each other and the tooth has not come in occlusion, then it is going to be a vertical impaction. If the mesial aspect of the long axis of the line is going to touch the long axis of 7, then it is mesangular. If the distal aspect of the line is going to touch meet below, then it is going to be distal angular. And if they are perpendicular, these lines are perpendicular to each other, then it is going to be horizontal. So this is how you come to a conclusion what type of impaction it is. What is war lines? Based on the Winter classification, three lines are drawn to assess the difficulty of an impacted tooth, which is called as white line, amber line and red line. So white line is the one which is drawn on the occlusal surface of 6 and 7, first and second molar, and then extended distally over the occlusal surface of third molar, whereas the amber line is drawn over the interdental bone and then extended posteriorly over the third molar, and red line is drawn, or an imaginary line dropped from the amber line, which indicates the approximate point of elevation for removing the impacted tooth. So each line has got their own significance. So the white line will tell you where the depth of the impacted tooth is. So if you want to measure the depth from the white line, you can measure at what depth the impacted tooth is placed. The amber line will tell you the amount of bone covering over the impacted tooth, which means that those amount of bone has to be gutted or removed for removing the tooth. Whereas red line tells you how much will be the depth or the point, and it will show the difficulty of removal. Another type of assessment is Warface assessment. So the Warface stands for Winter's classification, height of the mandible, angulation of third molar, root shape, follicles and path of exit. So after preoperative evaluating the radiograph and planning for the surgical removal, the following steps has to be done to remove the impacted third molar. So local anesthesia is preferred mostly to remove the third molar. After anesthesia is given, then incision is made with number 15 BP blade, when the mucoperiosteal flap is raised, then the amount of bone covering has been removed, then tooth is removed. If needed, tooth split is done, wound debridement done, hemostasis achieved, wound closure done, followed by post-operative follow-up. The surgical access is more important as it decides the flap design. The flap design is the one which decides the access to the impacted tooth. The flap is based on the standard principle of flap design, which should have a broader base, should lie on a sound bone after the tooth is removed, and also there should be less pocket formation distal to second molar after the surgery is being done. So all flaps which have been designed should meet all these criteria for designing a flap. So John Thoms was the first one to gain access through the mucoperiosteal flap. So there are three standard flap designs which has been followed in surgical removal of third molar, which is L-shaped, enveloped, and bayonet flap. The triangular flap is the one which has got a distal arm and a mesial arm, whereas the bayonet flap has got a distal arm and an intermediate arm which encircles the tooth, and then mesial arm. So the incision is given in such a way that an anterior limb, an intermediate limb, and a posterior limb is there for a flap that has been designed. Whereas the enveloped flap has got only a distal arm, whereas the other arms like anterior and intermediate follows the crevice of the margin and it extends till the distal aspect of the premolar. After the incision is given, a mucoperiosteal flap is raised. A periosteal elevator is used to raise the flap. When raising the flap, be cautious. Avoid buttonhole complication will result in delayed or compromise in the vascularity of the flap. After reflection, use retractors to retract the flap. The most common retractor that has been used will be an L-shaped retractor, which is called Austin retractor. There are also other types of retractors like Ball, Henry, and so forth. After the flap is raised and retracted, the bone that surrounds the tooth has to be removed. So bone removal is done either with chisel and mallet, which is very rarely followed nowadays, or with a burr. The burr technique is the one which has been commonly followed nowadays, and micromortar is the one which is used to gutter the bone for removal of the tooth. As already said, the amount of bone to be removed is determined by drawing an imaginary amber line and knowing that the tooth is being impacted, tooth bone removal is being done. So with the burr, try to gutter the bone until you see the cervical margin of whichever impacted tooth is, so that it becomes easy or a guideline for you clinically to know where or until where you need to do a bone guttering. So this slide shows a comparison between a chisel and mallet and a burr technique. So chisel and mallet is difficult and it's no longer being practiced. Burr it is easy as it is rotatory and time consuming. Chisel and mallet not tolerated, whereas burr is well tolerated. The fracture of bone is relatively high, is least possible in burr technique. Whereas the advantage of chisel and mallet is healing of bone is good, and the healing of bone is delayed if there is no proper technique followed, like irrigating the burr when it is cutting. The postoperative edema is less in chisel and mallet where it is more. The incidence of dry socket is less in chisel and mallet where it is high in the burr technique. Postoperative infection is less where it is more in burr technique. The burr technique is more widely used because it can be used in all type of impactions, whereas chisel and mallet, if it's very deeply seated like class 3 position C, it becomes more difficult. So as I already explained to you what class 3 and position C is, so that's the most difficult impaction, mandibular impaction, as per Pellengreri's classification. So if you're going to do a chisel technique, for information, this is what it has been done. The incision is made, flap raised, vertical limit cut is made with 3 mm chisel or 5 mm chisel, distal to the second molar. The chisel is placed 45 degree angle to the limiting cut. Buccal and distal bone are removed. The point of elevation is created in the anterior limiting cut region and the tooth is elevated. Whereas the burr technique, it is called as Moore or collar technique. The flap is raised. A rosette burr is used to create a gutter bone on the buccal aspect, or a straight fissure burr is being used to gutter the distal aspect of the tooth. Lingual soft tissue should be protected with periosteal elevator so that to avoid injury to the lingual nerve. The mesial point of application is created and the tooth is elevated, and tooth split is done if it is needed. So this picture shows how a bone guttering is being done. So you can clearly see a gutter that has been formed around the impacted tooth. Tooth division. A burr is used to expose the crown. A two-point application on the crown and the buccal side of the root has been made. The crown is separated, and then tooth and root are removed separately, or half of the tooth and half of the root are removed. It means based on how the path of exit of the tooth. So how you determine the path of exit of the tooth? You keep a dot on the distal aspect of the root and draw an arc passing through the mesial aspect of the crown of the impacted tooth. When drawing the arc, if the second molar comes in the way of the arc, then the tooth has to be split. So that is what is shown in figure A. So the arc is drawn. You can see the second molar coming in line with the arc. So it has to go for tooth split. So once the tooth is split, the arc of rotation, the point changes. So earlier it was in the distal tooth. Now the arc of rotation after splitting has come to the mesial aspect of the tooth. So now you can see the arc doesn't pass through. So if you keep the point on the mesial aspect of the apex of the impacted tooth and draw an arc, it doesn't pass through the second molar. Whereas if you want to sagittally split the tooth, it's totally a different scenario. So you can take the crown out and then Your space is created, and then you need to move the roots in the space and then take it out. The lateral definition technique is a technique which is most commonly was in practice when there is no root formation, and it is mostly done in the age group of 9 and 16. It was described by Boulder Henry. A modified S-shaped incision is made in the retromolar fossa. This leaves 5 mm cuff around the tooth. Eucopericial flap raised. Buccal cortical plate is refined over the third molar area. Vertical cuts are given. Anterior and posterior vestibule and buccal bowl removed and tooth elevated out. So this is the picture to show how lateral definition technique is done. So tooth is totally unerupted. A safe incision you can see in figure D. You can see a burr hole is being done that is connected, and then a chisel is used to split that or refine the lateral aspect of the buccal bone and then remove the tooth. The lingual strip technique is more commonly in practice before the use of burr. It was described by William Kelsey Fry and popularized by Ward. So incision placed and mucopericial flap raised. The usual way, a limiting vertical cut is made on the distal aspect of the second molar. Distal lingual bone removed by placing 5 mm chisel distal third molar. The bevel facing upward and cutting edge parallel to the external oblique ridge. The lingual bone is split obliquely backward. So this picture is taken from the textbook of Killian K, because it is clinically nobody practice nowadays. Just for your information, how it has been evolving from chisel to burr. So all the techniques are practiced earlier for surgical removal of the impacted mandibular third molar. So after the tooth removal, then the wound is cleaned with betadine solution, then wound irrigated. Check for sharp boring margins. So the picture B shows that the bone file is being used to trim the sharp margins, because of the bone guttering with the burr can leave a ledge of bone. And then after trimming, suture has been done with 30 silk. So what are the complications that you expect? The complications are hemorrhage, tearing of flap, TMJ symptoms, fracture of adjacent tooth, displacement of tooth, subcutaneous emphysema, pain, edema, hematoma, nursory neurosensory disturbances, trismus, and alveolar rhabdoid after this. In this, if you see hemorrhage, tearing of flap, TMJ symptoms, fracture of adjacent tooth, displacement of, and subcutaneous emphysema, or the intraoperative complications that you can expect, there is pain, edema, hematoma, neurosensory disturbances, and trismus, and alveolar osteitis or postoperative complication. So you can read in detail if Ian Peterson about each complication and how it has been managed, because that itself is a separate class to be taken on. So now I just named the complication, that is intraoperative and postoperative. So what are the consequences of removal? So 10-30% develop dry socket, 2-3% noticed impact sensation or damage in inferior alveolar. Relatively high pocket formation distal to second molar if your incision is not properly placed and planned. Damage to the adjacent tooth may occur. Deeply placed impacted tooth can cause fracture of the mandible, because if we keep on removing the bone to access the tooth, then you can land up in fracturing the tooth when you elevate the tooth. Then postoperative complication like pain, swelling, infection are seen in 50% of the cases. As age advances, medically compromised and healing are adversely affected. Bone becomes brittle and sclerosed. The retention of teeth may lead to infection, cystic and neoplastic formation. So if you leave the impacted tooth, these are the things which you will come across if it is not removed on time. So we have seen about a mandibular third molar. What is impaction? What are the classification of impaction? What is the radiological assessment of impaction? How do you determine the difficulty of impaction? How the surgical procedure has been conducted? And what are the complications that can happen? So in the next class, we will see about canine impaction and how it is managed. Thank you.